Hello, and welcome to the Castle Talk podcast, where we talk to writers and creators of today's genre worlds from Denver, Colorado. I'm your host, Jason Henderson, co-author of the new book, California Tiki, out now from the History Press. Tonight, in Killer Kate, which comes out in theaters on VOD on October 26th, soon-to-be bride Angie invites her estranged sister Kate to her bachelor party at a remote house booked on a home-sharing app. The women are unaware that by booking this house, they're walking into a trap set in motion by a disturbed family of amateur killers, signaling the beginning of basically a life-and-death cat-and-mouse struggle that pits family against family. So, the trailer is up. We have an exclusive clip up on bleedingcool.com. It's very exciting. It's a very funny trailer as well. It's funny and scary. The director is Elliot Feld, making his directorial debut. He says the family versus family thriller film was inspired by many of the low-budget flicks of the 70s and 80s. Welcome, Elliot.
Hi, how's it going?
Fantastic. I'm actually really excited to talk about this because, you know, I see a lot of movies, and what strikes me just looking at the trailer, because I haven't seen the whole film yet, what strikes me looking at the trailer is this looks like a very enclosed adventure. I mean, just cover, home sharing app leads them to a house. And is that the central location of most of the action?
Yeah, definitely. The majority of the movie takes place at this house, right? This cabin in the woods, if you will. So, you know, we sort of spend a little bit of the beginning of the movie getting the girls introduced, and then we send them up there. And then it turns into hack and slash a little bit.
You said that you looked at a lot of thrillers from the 70s and 80s as guidance on this. I mean, what sort of signposts do those thrillers give to a director if you're going to try to make a thriller like this?
Yeah, totally. No, and to be clear, you know, Killer Kate is like a horror comedy, so there's a lot of the Sam Raimi inspiration in it. I loved what he did with his earlier stuff, and he still did it even when he made Darkman and the Spider-Mans, and he made Drag Me to Hell, where he just does a really good job of balancing horror and comedy, and the comedy tends to be actually fairly slapstick. So if anybody's seen Evil Dead 2 or Army of Darkness, they'd know what I'm talking about. And those movies are just such an inspiration for me, because it's different, right? It's not like we have to watch people just die for 2 hours. It's fun to kind of have fun. And when we sit down and we watch these horror movies, we can laugh a little bit and just enjoy it, almost like it's a ride as opposed to just a straight slasher flick. And so a lot of those Sam Raimi movies from the 80s, and John Carpenter inspired a lot of the music and some of the overall tone. And he's just such a good filmmaker overall, you know, framing shots and his ability to tell a story in a short amount of time. You know, he really wasn't often going over an hour, 45 or 2 hours. And we knew we kind of want to follow in those footsteps.
So you had to write it to sort of fit that. I mean, I'm thinking about certainly Sam Raimi's Evil Dead 2. Halloween takes place, you know, the big bulk of it takes place in like one house, you know, or two houses running back and forth.
Yep.
So you had to write it with that in mind, I assume. And you wrote it with a partner, isn't that right?
Yeah. So Daniel Moya was my co-writer on the script, and we wrote it together. And totally, we knew we had this one house. Obviously, at this independent level that we're at, we usually know kind of the amount of money and the schedule that we're going to have before we go into making the movie. Whereas like some of these studio films, they're going to write the script, and then they get a line producer and an AD team on, and they kind of determine, you know, how long the schedule is going to be, and maybe even adjust where the budget's going to land. But we were in a corner, and we had certain tools at our disposal. And so we had to write the screenplay knowing all of that. So yes, we wrote it as a one location thriller, horror thriller. And as we said, you know, there's always more locations, right? There's rare, unless it's like Buried, that Ryan Reynolds movie that literally takes place inside a coffin the whole time. Usually there's four or five locations, and like 90% of the movie takes place in one of them. And that's what we've got, right? So we bounce around a little bit, but for the majority of the film, we're in this house.
It's just like a reservoir dogs. People remember it taking place all inside of the same warehouse, but actually there's restaurants, there's hotels, there's all this stuff along the way. you get there.
Yeah, totally. It's just the centerpiece.
So is that how this, you said at an independent, forgive me for asking a lot of these nuts and bolts kind of questions, but I think the readers will be interested in this. At this independent level, do you know that this movie is getting made before you start writing it? I mean, is this a case where somebody's like, I think I have an assignment for you if you can come up with the right script? Or how does it come together?
For this one, we knew it was going to get made when we started writing it. We had a certain amount of money and resources. We were actually working on another screenplay at the time called The Woods, which is like a more of a straight vampire horror movie. It was very haunting, mm-hmm. a one-woman show. And, you know, we knew Alex, my wife, who plays Kate, we wanted a vehicle for her to star in. And so when we were writing The Woods, like I said, we wrote this one-woman show horror. But mm-hmm. when we started to put the pieces together logistically, that movie didn't really seem like a reality. It just requires a little bigger budget and schedule. It all takes place in the snow, which can be really difficult to film in. So we had everything. So and we put The Woods on hold and started writing Killer Kate, knowing we were going to make it. So when we wrote the script, one of the things that was really nice is we knew the resources we had, so we could kind of write the script to cater to those.
So you know that your star was going to be your spouse, and I'm curious about this because if you've got a partner, you and your partner are at the Starbucks or the basement or wherever you're writing this script, did you have to bear mm-hmm. in mind whether she would object to different portions of the, in other words, like, I can see this, it'd be true of any actor you knew intimately, you know, I can see this actor reading this line, I can't see this actor reading this line. I mean, that I can see that actually being a positive thing.
Yeah, totally. It's always, for lack of a better word, it's always easier to write for a specific actor because you know their strengths and their weaknesses. Luckily with Alex, she's really versatile and she comes from a theater background, so she her acting skills are sort of like off the charts. So it was really, and she's never been on the screen before, so it was really fun to kind of play with the script and put her in a position where she could be a normal girl and then and also a total badass at the end of the movie, and she's able to kind of handle all of it, so that was really fun. At the beginning of the movie she's very much like her father's daughter and her sister's sister, and then at the end she's like the Sarah Connor hero, so it's really a great piece for her. It's really exciting. When we wrote the script, we knew we could play with it and have fun with it, and she would be able to handle everything.
There's this moment in the trailer where that opens up. It's sort of the thing that opens the trailer where she wants to get the attention of a guy behind the counter, and when we turn back, mm-hmm. she takes a beat. Her face is covered in blood, and she takes a beat, and then she says a line. And the beat does everything. There's so much like intelligence in the sort of waiting and the consternation and the frustration and all of that. It's really neat. I mean, that's a cool moment. So I'm curious. This is your directorial debut. What are the parts of the director job that, like, imagine you're at a cocktail party and you go, you know what, I never expected about being a director. What are the parts of the job that just surprise you, like that you never sort of pictured yourself having to do?
No, that's a great question. You know, I've directed a lot of commercial work and short films. I'm a commercial producer and director full time. So, you know, there's not a lot you can throw at me that would be totally shocking, but I guess I got to pick something, right? So what was the surprise? I would say that how fast the time moves on a feature and the importance and struggle that it is to keep the characters consistent, right? So, and I said this, I was talking on another interview where I said this, and the more I think about it, it's so true that like on a commercial, you shoot for one day and you're out. So it's kind of easy to get everything then right there in the moment. It's different when you got to go to bed 10 times in a row and wake up and you're feeling different every day. And you're trying to go to set and everybody's feeling different, right? Mm. It's every day is a new day and you have different challenges, but you have to maintain these actors' performances across that entire schedule and keep them consistent. So they're the same character on day one as day 10. And as most people know, you're not shooting chronologically. So for instance, day one, we were shooting the middle of the film, and day 8, we're shooting the first scene. So that would probably be the biggest challenge, I guess.
I never thought about that
chronologically.
I mean, the business of, besides like just the continuity of was a coffee cup on this side of the table or that, but that continuity of performance, like if an actor is coming on really manic, but they've never done this part that way for the previous 4 days of shooting, you would have to say, hey, interesting choice, but that, but this is not the character you've been playing for the past like several days. That's interesting. I never thought about that.
Yeah, totally. It's, you know, it's one of, it, you know, it's one of those things like if you shoot scene 13 on day one,
yeah,
and she's really upset. And then on day four, you got to go shoot scene 12. And she's not upset. You got to think, well, when we shot this on day one, you were here. So we need to get you back there. So it feels like this scene is supposed to come after the scene that came before it. Does that make sense?
It does. And it makes me amazed that anybody gets anything done. There's this.
I know, right?
It's I can swear it's a Werner Herzog movie. I can't remember where somebody says something like, I started out, I wanted to make great movies, and now I just want to finish them. it's so hard to do these things. But it's like being a CEO. I mean, you know, in the end, any choice that's going to get made, you know, you're working before the movie starts shooting, and then you're working after the movie stops shooting. In theory, you cut the movie, isn't that right? You edit it yourself.
Carter
or do directors? Yeah, forgive editors, the ignorant question.
It depends, you know. Some directors edit the movie, some don't. We had an editor named Carter Fuhrerhelm, and I gave him a few weeks to edit it where I didn't have to look at the film. That way I could just get my eyes off it and try to be as objective as possible. Yeah. And then after the few weeks, I sat down with him for a month or two, and every day we would go through the edit and clean and clean and clean and work on it together. I would say the majority of directors have an editor. And I think for young directors, one thing I'd say, a lot of young directors coming out of film school, they love to direct or they love to edit their own stuff.
Uh-huh.
I think having an editor is so important because you get that objective eye, you know, somebody different in there. And it can help a lot with tone and style.
That's fabulous. You know, it's funny. It strikes me now that the path of independent thrillers, which I'm seeing a lot of lately, and there's this, mm-hmm. this like 1-2-3 punch of, you know, some theater, some VOD, some whatever. It's almost like the multiple channels that we had I was a very little kid, but that we had in the 70s, where you've got drive-ins and you've got various other ways for all these different, you know, for different movies to find different audiences.
This afternoon we watched Halloween, the new one. And I loved it. I thought it was awesome. And it's just amazing how much movies have changed, but also in ways kind of remain the same sometimes, like that thread, you know, because the movie's so fresh, the music's fresh, the technology's new, the actors are new, everybody's got iPhones, so that has to be incorporated.
Yeah.
But there's some really cool stuff in the new Halloween that just kind of like harkens back to the old one that makes it nostalgic. I don't know if you've seen it yet. I loved it.
I have.
It was awesome.
We have a panel show made up of comic book writers who talk about horror movies. We've been watching through the Halloween horror films. I really thought they did an excellent job. For me to find something at fault with it would be nitpicking. It's a very strong picture. One thing though that makes me think of with Killer Kate that I wanted to ask you about is it looks to me like this is an extremely woman heavy cast, in the same way that I don't think this is a spoiler about Halloween, but Halloween kind of the men. It's almost like Steel Magnolias with knives, because the men are completely ancillary to the story. That other than the one that's trying to kill them all, the men don't matter. And that's sort of what's going on in Killer Kate as well. You've got this extremely female cast. Is that something that just happened, or are you aware of trends that make that more attractive for a director to do right now, or what? Because I definitely think it's of the moment.
Yeah, totally. It is, and people notice that. There's a lot going around. There's a lot of female empowerment happening right now, and having the female lead is really important. And I'm excited about it, obviously. But I think when we write, and I think some of the best films that do it, especially James Cameron's movies, you know, when you think of Aliens with Ripley, and you think of Sarah Connor and Terminator, I try to do it as blindly as possible. So we knew we were going to have a female lead, and that's it. Now go make your movie, right? So you don't, you just, it's a, if you're going to, I'm going to cast Alex, she's my wife, I'm going to write this character to be awesome. And that's all there is to it. I tried not to overthink it. And when I watched Halloween today, like you were saying, yeah. I didn't even notice it until the end, which is a good thing. You know, it yeah. shouldn't be blatant and in your face. It should just be a good movie and have great female characters. And that's what's important. You know, and it was awesome that at the end, there's a shot. I don't want to give anything away, but there's a shot where we're in the camera's in the basement and it's looking up the staircase. Yeah. And, you know, Michael Myers is, at this point, trapped in the basement, is all I'll say. And you see the three heroes, you know, Jamie Lee Curtis and her daughter and her granddaughter, and they're there in like a three shot, and they're just this heroic female trio, you know. And
yes.
It's awesome, but it's not in your face. It just exists in that story. The story has to be told that way. It doesn't feel like a square peg in a round hole. It just feels like a really well-written movie with awesome women characters. And that's what we try to do with Killercade is, and some people say we turn the trope on its head, like the cabin in the woods. It's always that thing where people go up to the cabin in the woods, it's a bunch of girls and guys, and all the girls get killed off and the guy saves the day. But in order, we just wrote four girls go up and that's it. Uh-huh. And they're going to fight back. You know, they're going to fight back and they're going to win. And that's how this movie is going to play out.
I'm really excited.
And so,
Yeah, because I've only seen the trailer so far, but it's definitely my kind of thing, and it's coming out in less than 10 days, so I really can't wait to get a chance to see it and talk about it on our show. So, very cool.
Cool.
All right, so as we said, Killercade comes out on October 26th in select theaters and on VOD. And its director is Elliot Feld, and I'm so thankful that you would spend the time talking about it. I have a feeling we could just sort of keep talking about low-budget movies probably for hours, but I really enjoyed your time, and tell your wife that she appears to be doing a really fine job, and I can't wait to see it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.